one student. This is Ravi, Assistant Professor, Department of Treasury, UASB, Kavali. So in the previous class, I discussed about introduction to the magnetic material and some terms connected to the magnetic material. And after that, I discussed about classification of magnetic material and some applications of those materials. And in this class, I am going to discuss magnetically induced EMF and force. And after that, I will discuss self and mutual inductances. And after that, I will discuss AC operation of magnetic circuits. And after that, I discuss eddy current and hysteresis losses in the magnetic material. Okay. So, firstly, I will start with the magnetically induced EMF and force. Okay. Magnetically induced EMF and force concept firstly. Okay. So, according to Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, according to Faraday's law of induction or Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, you know already E is equal to small e is equal to minus N into d phi by dt. So here we will write N phi as the d delta by dt. So that's why we will write this equation as E is equal to minus d delta by dt. So where delta is equal to N phi, that is equal to flux linkages of the coil, that is Weber. Weber per turn, that is the delta, and therefore E is equal to N into d phi by dt. You will write this equation, so E is equal to N into d phi by dt, so that is equal to d delta by dt. And next, the dynamically induced EMF with respect to B and VR, the dynamically induced EMF E with respect to B and VR, you will write the equation as E is equal to det V bar into V bar into L, that is equal to BLV psi theta. This is the dynamically induced EMF with respect to B and V. That is equal to BLV sin theta. So since theta is equal to 90 degrees, so you know already sin theta, that is theta is equal to 90 something here, that is BLV sin of 90. You know already sin 90 is 1. That's why the equation will be rewrite as E is equal to BLV. BLV. So the direction of this EMF can be given by Fleming's right hand rule. The direction of this EMF can be given by Fleming's right hand rule, that is, so this is the diagram representation of the Fleming's right hand rule. So put the right hand fingers, three fingers like this. Okay, this is the thumb and this is the forefinger and this is the index finger. Okay, so this is the middle finger and this is the, so this one is the middle finger and this is the forefinger we are taking. So thumb, middle finger and forefinger, these three put like this, and this forefinger, this one, this four, the forefinger indicates magnetic field direction. Okay, magnetic field direction. And middle finger, this one, so this middle finger indicates current direction. And last we have thumb, so this thumb indicates motion of the conductor. Okay, motion of the conductor. Okay, so this one gives the motion of the conductor, and this one gives the current direction, and this one gives the magnetic field direction. Okay, this is the Fleming's right hand rule. Next, coming to the self and mutual inductances, self and mutual inductances, that is from Faraday's law. We are taking E is equal to capital N into d phi by dt, and that is equal to N into d phi by dt into di by d phi by di. We will write d phi by dt in another form, that is d phi by di into di by dt. So this is exactly equal to the d phi by dt form. D phi by di into di by dt, that is equal to, we will write this one as L into di by dt. So from Faraday's law of induction, E is equal to L into di by dt. So where L is equal to N into d phi by di. So in the place of N into d phi by di, we will write the L. Okay, so that is equal to, you know already N into d phi by dt is equal to d phi by di is equal to, that is d delta by di. Okay, that is Henry's. So L is the inductance. So the units of the inductance is Henry's. Okay, so therefore L is equal to delta by I. Therefore L is equal to delta by I. So the inductance can be written in terms of field quantities as L is equal to N square into B A by H L. N square into B A by H L. We will rewrite this equation as N square into mu, that is the B by H. B by H we will write as mu into A by L. A by L. So that is equal to N square by R. So that is equal to N square by R. So that is equal to N square into P Henry's. That is L is equal to N square into R Henry's, or N square into P Henry's. N square by R or N square into P Henry's. This is the inductance in terms of field quantities. In terms of field quantities, next. The inductance concept is easily extendable to mutual inductance. The inductance concept is easily extendable to mutual inductance of two coils sharing a common magnetic circuit, as that is M12 is equal to delta 12 by I2 Henry's and M21 is equal to delta 21 by I1 Henry's. So where delta 12 is the flux linkages of coil 1, flux linkages of coil 1 due to current in coil 2. Flux linkages of coil 1 due to current in coil 2, and delta 21 is the flux linkages of coil 2 due to current in coil 1. Okay. So for a bilateral circuit, M is equal to root of L1 L2. For a bilateral circuit, M is equal to root of L1 L2. There is a mutual inductance. So in general, M is equal to K into root of L1 L2. So where K is equal to coupling coefficient, so which can be at most unity. So you know coefficient of coupling concept in the electrical circuits, so you already know that one. So from that we write M is equal to K into root of L1 L2. So here K is the coupling coefficient. Okay, this is most unity. K is unit, that is K is equal to 1. So therefore, in static magnetic configuration, L is fixed independent of time. So the induced EMF can be given as, that is, E is equal to N into d phi by dt, that is equal to N into, so I already said that in the previous slide, that is d phi by dt I will write as d phi by dA into dI by dt, and last we will write this one as E is equal to L into dA by dt. So in rotating devices, both L and I vary with time, that is delta is equal to L into I, and the induced EMF can be given as E is equal to L into dA by dt plus I into dL by dt, that is L into dA by dt for the statically induced EMF, and I into dL by dt gives the dynamically induced EMF. Statically induced EMF and dynamically induced EMF. The combination of these two is called induced EMF. Okay. Next, coming to the force, that is force of the electromagnetic origin is given by, that is DF is equal to IDL into B. So the total force is obtained as F is equal to H into B. So that is equal to BH into sin theta into AF newtons. That is the force, total force. So here we will write, so for theta is equal to 90, which is used in most machine configurations, that is F is equal to BIL, okay, newtons. That is the most machine configuration, that is equal to, sorry, for theta is equal to 90. So which is used in most machine configurations, that is F is equal to BIL newtons. Okay, so F is equal to IL into B bar, that is equal to B into IL sin theta AF. Okay, and next, coming to the next concept, that is AC operation of the magnetic circuits. AC operation of the magnetic circuits. So, for establishing a magnetic field, the energy must be spent. Through to energy is required to maintain it. So for establishing a magnetic field, energy must be spent through to energy is required to maintain it. So take the example of the existing coils of an electromagnet. Okay, take the example of the existing coils of electromagnet. The energy supplied to it is spent in two ways. The energy supplied to it is spent in two ways for the existing coils of electromagnet. That is, part of it goes to meet I square R loss. Okay, part of it goes to meet I square R loss, or copper loss is lost once for all. I square R loss and is lost once for all. Okay, next, second one is, part of it goes to create flux. Part of it goes to create flux and is stored in the magnetic field, and is stored in the magnetic field as potential energy. And is stored in the magnetic field as potential energy, and is similar to the potential energy of a raised weight, where a mass m is raised to a height of h. The potential energy stored in it is mgh. Okay. So this mechanical potential energy can be recovered can be electric energy stored in the magnetic field. Okay, this mechanical potential energy can be recovered, so can be electric energy stored in a magnetic field. So when current through an inductive coil is gradually changing from zero to maximum, when current through the inductive coil is gradually changing from zero to maximum value, then every change of it is opposed by the self-induced EMF. Okay, then every change of it is opposed by the self-induced EMF. So produced due to this change, energy is needed to overcome this opposition. So this energy is stored in the magnetic field of the coil. And is later on recovered when those fields collapse. Okay. Field of the coil and is later on recovered when those field collapse. So in many applications and machines such as transformers and AC machines, the magnetic circuits are excited by AC supply. So in such an operation, inductors plays vital role even in steady state operation through in DC. It acts as a short circuit. So, in such case, the flux is determined by the AC voltage applied and frequency. Thus, the existing current has to adjust itself according to flux so that every time BH relationship is satisfied. So, this is the one material we are taking. So, in this one, we are taking a core. So, actually, it has one winding. So here we are taking one coil or winding. It consists of n number of turns, and it also consists of current I. And in between the core we have one dotted line. It is in the circular shape, that is the rectangular shape, that is the flux line, that is the flux, that is phi. Okay. So consider a coil. So here we are considering a coil. Okay. On the core. Okay. It consists of n number of turns, that is capital N turns. Okay, wound on the iron core, that is the core, this is the core. Okay, it is wound on the iron core, as shown in the diagram. So here, the coil carries an alternating current, that is I. Okay, the coil carries a current I, that is the alternating current I, that is varying sinusoidally. Okay, so thus, the flux produced by the existing current I is also sinusoidally varying with the time. So here we have flux. So this flux is produced by the circulating current I, that is the, it is also alternating in nature, that is with the time it is in the sinusoidal. So here phi m we will take, that is phi m is the maximum value of flux in core, and omega is the 2 pi f, okay, where f is the frequency in hertz. So according to Faraday's law, as flux changes with respect to coil, the EMF gets induced in the coil is E is equal to N into d phi by dt. So that is equal to, you will write as n into d phi by dt, then phi is equal to phi m sin omega t. So phi is equal to phi m sin omega t substitute here, that is n into d phi by d by dt of phi m into sin omega t. So after simplifying that one, we have E is equal to n into phi m of omega into cos omega t volts. That is the induced EMF in the coil, and EM is equal to maximum value, so that is equal to n into phi m into omega. M into phi m into omega, and E is equal to RMS value, that is equal to maximum value by root 2, that is EM by root 2, so that is equal to n into phi m by root 2 omega, so that is equal to RMS value, E is equal to n into phi m into omega, means omega is equal to, you know, that is 2 pi f, that is n into phi m into 2 pi f by root 2, so that is equal to 4.4, 1 by root 2 means 1 by root 2 into 2 means, that is 4.44 f into m into phi m, but phi m is equal to ac into bm. So where ac is the area of cross section of core and bm is the maximum flux density in Weber per meter square. Maximum flux density in Weber per meter square. So the sign of EMF induced must be determined according to Lenz's law. Okay, Lenz's law. The sign of EMF induced must be determined according to Lenz's law, that is opposing the changes in the flux. Opposing the changes in the flux. So the current and flux are in phase as current produces flux instantaneously. The current and flux are in phase as current produces flux instantaneously. So now induced EMF is cosine term and thus leads the flux and current by, this is called back EMF as it opposes the applied voltage. Okay, so the resistance drops is very small and is neglected 3D in most of the electromagnetic devices. The resistance drops is very small and is neglected 3D in most of the electromagnetic devices. Okay, so the instantaneous, now we are moving to the energy stored under AC operation. Okay, energy stored in AC operation, that is the instantaneous electric power input into the magnetic circuit through the coil terminals is given by, that is electric power P is equal, instantaneous electric power input as P is equal to EI, you know already E is equal to d delta by dt, then P is equal to I into d delta by dt. Next, the power is rate of change of energy, the power is rate of change of energy, hence energy input which gets stored in the magnetic field during the interval T1 to T2 is, that is WT is equal to, sorry, WF is equal to integral T1 to T2 P dt is equal to integral T1 to T2 P means I into d delta by dt into dt, and next we have WF is equal to integral delta 1 to delta 2, that is I into d delta. We will write this equation as like these terms, WF and in terms of delta d delta by dt in terms of with respect to P and with respect to delta. So thus WF is the increase in the field energy as the flux linkages of the coil changes from I1 to I2 during the interval, that is T1 to T2 is, now HEIE is equal to LE is equal to MF, that is equal to N into I. So from this one I am writing I is equal to HCIC by N. HCIC is equal to N into I, then I is equal to HCIC by N. So using the equation number 5, this is the equation number 1, we will write WF is equal to integral delta 1 by delta 2 is I is HCIC by N into d delta, that is from this equation. Okay, WT, WF is equal to integral delta 1 delta 2 into I d delta. So in I plus we are substituting HCIC by N into d delta, but delta is equal to, you know, delta is equal to N into phi, and phi is equal to BC into AC, that is delta is equal to N into AC into BC. So the flux density of the core is changing from B1 to B2 as the flux linkage changes from I1 to I2, that is WF is equal to integral B1 to B2 of HCIC by N into N into AC into BBC, make WF is equal to ACIC integral B2 to B1 HC BBC. This is the energy stored under AC operation. Okay. Next, thus is the field energy in terms of field quantities. Now ACIC is equal to volume of the core, then WF per unit volume is equal to integral B1 to B2 HC BC into D into joules per meter cube. This is called field energy density. This is called field energy density. And next, coming to the hysteresis and eddy current losses in the magnetic material is, so when magnetic materials are subjected to an alternating flux, okay, when magnetic materials are subjected to an alternating flux phi, two types of losses occur, which are hysteresis loss and eddy current loss. So the above losses compute the total losses, okay, total core loss, not total losses, it is the compute the total core loss, that means iron loss. Coming to the first one, that is hysteresis loss. So below Curie temperature, that is, it is the rising temperature. Curie temperature means it is the rising temperature at which the given material ceases to be ferromagnetic, or the falling temperature at which it becomes ferromagnetic. Okay, so below Curie temperature, all ferromagnetic materials exhibit the phenomenon called hysteresis, which is defined as the lagging of magnetization or induction flux density, that is B, behind the magnetizing force H, or it is the quality of a magnetic substance due to which energy is dissipated in it on the reversal of its magnetism, reversal of its magnetism. So the diagram shows the hysteresis loop for ferromagnetic material. Okay, it is the typical hysteresis loop. So it is a curve plotted between B and H. For various values of H for A, from A maximum value in the positive direction to the maximum value in the negative direction. That's why the diagram is like this. And back again, that is like this. So starting at zero, that is this one, from this one, starting at zero, our origin point O, with a coil wound. Around a toroid of unmagnetized iron, the magnetization curve follows the curve that is OD, that is this one, OD, on the positive side. Next, if the MMF is gradually reduced, the flux curve follows the line DE, this one, okay. Next, as the MMF is reversed, the flux falls into the point L and hence to M. Okay, as the MMF is reversed, the flux falls into point L, okay, this one, and to M, that is in the negative direction, LM. Okay. Next, as the MMF is returned to zero, the flux traces out the path, that is MN, that is this one. Okay, MN. In the negative side. Then, as MMF is again increased, this curve MPD is followed. NPD, that is this one, NPD, from negative side to the positive side. NPD is followed. The area within the closed loop is a measure of energy loss during the cycle. So this energy is in effect a fractional loss and shows up as heat in the material. So the distance OE is a measure of the residual flux left in the closed magnetic circuit when the current is zero. OE, that is this one. OE, this is the area. And it is known as BR, that is the residual induction. So here the BR describes circuits. BR describes circuits in which there are no air gaps. There are no edges. For example, the iron toroid should not be confused with remnants. Okay, so a general term which refers to magnetic induction remaining in the magnetic circuit. Okay, the general term which refers to magnetic induction remaining in the magnetic circuit, usually in the area when one is present after magnetizing force has been removed. Remaining in the magnetic circuit after magnetizing force has been removed. So the distance OL is known as minus x3. The distance OL, that is this one. The distance OL is known as minus x3. That is the negative part of the H. Is known as minus x3. The coercive force and is the value of the demagnetizing MMF. This is the value of the demagnetizing MMF required to bring the residual or remanent magnetic induction to zero when such a loop is being traced out. That is the loop, that is this one, using the shape like this. Next, so if a ferromagnetic substance is subjected to an alternating MMF, the first hysteresis loops traced out do not necessarily fall upon each other. Okay, so when successive loops retrace the preceding one, the material is said to be in cyclically magnetized condition. Okay, the material is said to be in a cyclically magnetized condition. So for electromagnetic core materials, values of Br and minus Hc are determined from hysteresis loop taken when material is cyclically magnetized. Okay, so permanent magnet values, however, are taken from the first hysteresis loop, since permanent magnets need be magnetized only once. Next, the hysteresis loop equals the work. The hysteresis loop equals the work which is necessary to reverse the direction of magnetization. So the actual shape of area of loop, the actual shape and area of loop depend on the internal structure and composition of the ferromagnetic substance. So thus work done W is equal to area of BH loop, that is joules per meter cube per cycle. So while calculating the actual area, scales of B and H should be taken into consideration. So for example, if scales are, that is, Steinmetz developed an empirical relationship to express this loss in following terms, that is, hysteresis loss pH is equal to KH into F into BM for K. So in this expression, pH is the hysteresis loss in watt per meter cube per kg, and BM is the maximum flux density, that is Weber per meter square, and KH is the hysteresis coefficient, and K is the Steinmetz coefficient. So in BM power K, K is the Steinmetz coefficient and F is the frequency of magnetization in hedges. Okay, so the value of Steinmetz coefficient K is approximately 2 for all modern magnetic materials. So here we have to note that the transformers and generators cores and armatures of the electric motors, etc., which are subjected to rapid reversal of magnetization, should be made of such substances which have low coefficient in order to reduce the hysteresis loss. So here I listed a table which concerns the hysteresis coefficient. So here I am taking the materials and corresponding hysteresis coefficients. Okay. In joules per meter square, that is, firstly I am taking the material, that is cast iron. So the hysteresis coefficient value is K is equal to 28.63 to 40.2 joules per meter square. Okay, next I am taking the material, that is sheet iron. The value of coefficient, the hysteresis coefficient is 10.05. And third one, that is cast steel, that is the coefficient, the hysteresis coefficient value is 7.54 to 30.14. And after that, I will take the material, that is hard cast steel. So the hysteresis coefficient value is 63 to 70.34. and taken silicon steel. The stresses coefficient value is 1.91, and I am taking hard tungsten steel. The stresses coefficient value is 144.7, and after that I am taking good dynamo sheet steel. So here the stress coefficient value is 5.02, and I am taking mild steel castings. That is, the stress coefficient value is 7.54 to 22.51, and I am taking nickel. The stress coefficient value is 32.66 to 100.5, and lastly I am taking the alloy. That is, the stress coefficient value is 0.25. These are the different stress coefficient for the given materials. Okay, next we are moving to the second loss, that is eddy current losses. Okay, the term eddy currents is applied to those electric currents which circulate within a mass of conducting material, when the latter is situated in a varying magnetic field. Okay, the conducting material may be considered as consisting of large number of closed conducting bars, each of which behaves like a short circuited winding. So the varying magnetic field induces eddy EMFs in these closed elemental parts, giving rise to eddy currents. So these eddy currents produce loss in power, resulting in heating of materials. Okay, so this loss is of considerable importance as it affects the efficiency and the heating of electrical machines. So the eddy currents produce a magnetic field of their own, which opposes the main magnetic field. So as the effect of eddy currents is not uniform over the cross section of the material, this results in a flux distribution. Okay, so which is not uniform, the flux density in the outer portion being greater than that at the center. So thus there is a reduction in effective cross section. So the effect of eddy current upon flux distribution is chiefly of importance in transformers, where the material otherwise would be worked at a uniform flux density. So the magnetic materials used for varying the magnetic fields are laminated so as to reduce eddy currents and associated losses as by laminating the area of path of eddy current is reduced, giving rise to a large value of resistance. So coming to the next concept, there is eddy current loss in thin sheets. So here I will show the diagram. It shows a thin plate of thickness T and width B, thickness being considerably smaller than the width. So this is the diagram. This is the diagram for the eddy currents in laminations. Okay. So this is the eddy current loss in thin sheets. Here I am taking a sheet. It consists of the free magnetic field. Nothing but the flux. This is representing with the dotted line. So here we have the width and thickness, that is B and T, we are taking. Okay, here we have this is the width B and thickness T we are taking in this one, BT. So here the thickness is of the substance is 1 meter. So from this one, let us suppose that this sheet carries a flux B, that is B is equal to B maximum into sin T. The field running parallel to the axis of the sheet, so eddy currents will flow in the sheet in the elemental path as shown in this one. Okay. So let us consider 1 meter axial length. Okay, let us consider 1 meter axial length and also 1 meter width of sheet. So in this diagram, this one 1 meter, 1 meter. So this one, let us consider 1 meter axial length and also 1 meter width. 1 meter width. This one, 1 meter and 1 meter in this vertical position. Okay. Take an elemental path of thickness that is dx. Elemental path of length that is dx. This one. Okay. On the top of this sheet, we have dx of thickness dx at a distance. X at a distance x. This is the distance x in this arrow mark. In this one we have the distance at the top of this one particular position. So dx is the thickness and x is the distance from the axis. And flux enclosed by 1 meter length of this path is phi is equal to flux density into 2x into 1. That is the area. That is equal to 2xb. That is equal to 2xb into sine omega t. Phi is equal to 2xb into sine omega t. So instantaneous value of AD EMF induced in the elemental path is Ex is equal to d phi by dt. So that is equal to d by dt of phi value is 2xb into sine omega t, 2x into b sine omega t. So after simplifying this, we have 2x into b maximum into cos omega t. That is the differentiation of sine omega t is the cos omega t. And last we have 2x into omega b maximum cos omega t. Okay, we will write cos omega t is omega into cos omega t. This is the instantaneous value of induced EMF, AD EMF in the elemental path, Ex value. So RMS value of AD current in the elemental path is capital E RMS is equal to 1 by root 2 into E maximum. That is equal to 1 by root 2 into 2x into omega into B maximum. So that is E maximum is equal to, you know, RMS that is 2x into omega into B maximum. That is when cos omega t is equal to 1, that's why we have not taken omega t. That's why we have 2x into omega into B maximum. So that is equal to root 2x into omega into b maximum is equal to root 2 into x into omega means 2 pi f. So that into b maximum, that is equal to 2 root 2 pi x into f into b maximum. So if rho is the resistivity of material, if rho is the resistivity of the material, then the resistance of each elemental part is r is equal to 2 into rho by 1 into dx. So that is equal to 2 rho by dx. So neglecting portions of path here, that is parallel to edges of plates, that is eddy current in the elemental path, that is element path, that is Isc is equal to Ixc is equal to Esc by Rsc, that is equal to Esc means, you know, that is 2 root 2 into pi into 2 root 2 into pi into f into x into b maximum by Rsc means that is 2 rho by dx. So that is equal to root 2 into pi into f into b maximum into x into dx by rho. So eddy current crossing this path with 1 meter length and 1 meter width is Psc is equal to Isc square into Rsc. That is equal to 2 pi square into 2 pi square into f square into b square maximum into x into dx whole square by rho square, that into 2 rho by dx. And finally, after simplifying this, we have 4 pi square f square into bm maximum square by rho into x square dx. So total eddy current loss in a plate 1 meter wide, 1 meter long and t meters thick is just equal to root of, sorry, integral of x is equal to 0 to 1 by t by 2. That is, you know, already Ps value, that is 4 pi square into f square b maximum square by rho into x square into dx. After simplifying this, we have pi square f square into b maximum square by 6 rho into t square omega, t square rads. So eddy current loss per unit volume, that is equal to pi square f square b maximum square into t square by 6 rho. Then the volume being, that is t meter, that is ke into f square into ke into f square into b maximum square rad. So where ke is equal to pi square into t square by 6 rho. So in that one we are taking ke. Okay. So the thickness t of laminated material is of considerable importance as regards to eddy current loss. That is here my 8.16 equation, that is this one, pi square f square b maximum square into t square by 6 rho, shows that eddy current losses are reduced by using thinner plates and a material of higher resistivity. So, and the equation is derived by assuming that magnetic field is uniform throughout and parallel to the axis, and also the sheets are very thin. So, therefore, as such, it should be applied to cases where frequency is abnormal. The sheets thick are, the variation of flux density is not sinusoidal with the time. Okay. And the eddy current losses can be reduced by the following ways. That is, first one, it has been found that this loss can be minimized by building up the required cross section for the flux path by stacking these pieces known as laminations. So, since the EMF set up in the material by varying flux as usually of small magnitude, and the natural oxide on the surface of the sheet iron or steel from which the laminations are punched will effectively insulate the laminations from one each other, and thus limit each eddy current path to a single lamination. And second one is, this loss may also be reduced by grinding the ferromagnetic material to a powder and mixing it with a binder that effectively insulates the particles from one another. This mixture is then formed under pressure into the desired shape and heat treated. So, magnetic cores for use in accommodation equipment are frequently made by this process. So, iron losses, that is eddy current and hysteresis losses, if allowed to take place unchecked, not only reduce the efficiency of electrical equipment but also raise the temperature of the core. Hence, these losses should be kept as small as is economically possible. Okay. So, these are the topics we are covered in this class, that is AC operation of magnetic circuits and eddy current and hysteresis losses, and magnetically induced EMF, that is self induced EMF or mutually induced EMF and field. Okay. And in the next class, I am going to discuss, this is the first part of the first unit, that is the magnetic material and magnetic material properties and its application. And in the next class, I am going to start the second part, that is principles of electromagnetic and electromechanical energy conversion. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for watching this video.